Child, this video gets its own disclaimer, honey, because I am here to tell you that everything in this video is gossip. I got it from gossip websites. I don't have no facts for y'all because I do not know. I cannot confirm one thing in this video. So I just wanted to put that out there that all of this is alleged. Now let's get to the video.
What's up, Scandalites and Sesso Squad? This is Ashley with Ashley Sesso, and I am back with another old Hollywood scandals video. And I don't know if this video gonna blow y'all away, but baby, it sure enough blew me away because I didn't even know that this person had any teeth, like at all. But apparently, he was Mr. Big out here. For real. And we are definitely about to get into it, but before we do, young, rich, skinny, you know what it is, Sesso Squad for life. Now y'all, let's get into this sizzling, piping hot tea for Mr. Ronald, aka Mr. Biggs, Isley. Ronald Isley was born on May 21st, 1941 in Cincinnati, Ohio. His mother's name was Sally Bernice, and his father's name was O'Kelly Isley Sr. And Ronald was actually the third born of six brothers. Their names were O'Kelly Jr., Rudolph Isley, Vernon Isley, Ernie Isley, and Marvin Isley. And Ronald and his brothers, like many of the people on our list, began their career in the church. And they started them early too, honey. The first time Run got up and sang in front of the church, he was only 2 years old. And by the time Run was seven, he and his brother were doing even bigger things, like singing alongside Dinah Washington. Now, just to make things clear, Run Isley was not the lead singer of the group at this time. It was actually the brother right up under him, Vernon Isley. And baby, the folks say that y'all think Run is something, baby, they said Vernon had a voice on him. Now, by their early teens, the brothers really looked like they were going to become the next Dixie Hummingbird or the next soul stir. But per the word on the streets, the boys really wanted their chance at secular singing. But child, they said first the folks in the church had their eyes on them like this, and so they was a little bit scared to step out. And then out of nowhere, tragedy struck, and that is when younger brother and lead singer Vernon got hit by a car. He was riding his bicycle down the road and the car came and struck him, and sadly he did not survive. He was only 13 years old. And it's claimed that the family went through a really bad grieving period, and it's also said that the brothers had actually started to think that maybe they should stop singing altogether. And I am more than sure that this tragedy probably really stopped the thoughts of secular music, you know what I'm saying? Because it probably scared them. Y'all know how stuff happened, and you be sitting at that time and saying, oh Lord, you know, I'm sorry, I'm gonna stay in church and all this kind of stuff. That's probably what was going on too. But the tragedy happened in 1955, and after they set out for a couple of years, by 1957 they were back singing and they were back traveling the gospel circuit. And then Run, O'Kelly, and Rudolph, well actually the family calls him Rudy, they finally made up their mind to chase their dreams and sing secular music. So they had long talks with their parents, and they finally got their parents to see things their way, and so their parents let them move off to New York. And when they moved to New York, and with Run having the voice that he had, things started moving really quickly for them. I mean, they basically started off hitting stages left and right. But the problem was, the boys did not have their own music, so every time they hit the stage, they were actually singing Jackie Wilson's song. But they say Run was tearing the songs up so good that when they were done, the people were always begging for an encore. And so teen boys that sounded like this needed to be recorded, right? Well, the brothers thought so too. So next thing you know, they outside of the window, hey, Mr. Barry, give us a record deal. Ooh, wow, ooh, wow. I'm just kidding. That was Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers, but Mr. Richard Barrett is who the Isley brothers ended up hooking up with. And Richard Barrett could clearly see that these boys had talent, so he did take them to see George Goldner, which is the same person he took Frankie Lyman to see. And although George Goldner did record the Isley brothers, I do believe that he was giving better material to the Teenagers, because see, at this time, the Teenagers had already made it to fame, and actually they were trying to keep them on top. So like I said, the Isley brothers did record, but they didn't really have any good songs. Regardless of this though, the brothers kept on pushing, and they kept doing their live shows, still singing Jackie Wilson's songs. So whenever they would sing Lonely Teardrops, Run came up with this call and response part that he would add to the end of the song. And they say what it was is that when they would get to the end of the Lonely Teardrops songs, the audience, like I said, would be begging for an encore, and Run would do something like, you know, y'all showing us so much love, you know, y'all make me want to shout. And then from there on, he would get into, you know, you make me want to shout. And because this became such a popular thing to do, the Isley brothers figured, why don't we just turn this into a real song? But he needed an intro, so he listened to Ray Charles' I Got a Woman, and that intro, well, turned into, well, You know you make me wanna. And they came up with this song just in time because right around this time, RCA was looking to sign them. And you best believe that the Osley brothers were shouting for real. Baby, they was running around like they got the Holy Ghost, honey, because Shout was a huge hit. But then, child, they basically went from shouting all over the church because of joy to falling out and needing their prayer blanket spreaded on top of them because they could not follow up Shout with any hit. So they left RCA and they ended up getting with Scepter Records. And I guess when they got with Scepter Records, Run was like, man, this is some snapback biggity bull crap. We ain't had nothing happen for us since Shout. I wish we could record it again. Then Rudy was probably like, hey yo, that's a good idea though. Ain't nobody say nothing with Chubby Checo chubbed up to the frontier, did it with the twist. Talking about let's twist again. And then O'Kelly was probably like, I got it. Shout. Twist. That sounds stupid, O'Kelly. Man, shut up, Run. I'm talking about if you put twist in front of shout. Twist, shout. Twist and shout. I don't know if it actually happened like that, but when they got with Scepter Records, that was their next song, Twist and Shout. And once again, the Osley brothers were shouting for real because Twist and Shout was a major hit. In fact, it stayed on the chart for 19 weeks. Then, child, the next thing you know, folks sitting in the car listening to the radio and they hear the DJ say, Twist and Shout finna come on. Baby, them folks then fixed their lips to sing along with Run, and right when they finna sit up there and let loose, honey, John Lennon then came over the radio. Because yes, a little bit later, the Beatles definitely did re-record Twist and Shout, and they made it an even bigger hit than the Osley Brothers. But in the meantime, the Osley Brothers were still riding their wave, but then once again, the wave was cut short because they could not follow this up with any more hits. And honestly, it's really a shame because this song was so catchy and dancey and running around hollering and screaming and stuff. It really should have made them stars. Like, this should have been their staple song, but like I said, I don't know what happened. They just could not follow it up. But they did not let it get them down. They started thinking of other avenues to make money, and so they ended up opening their own recording studio. It's called T-Neck Records. And on top of this, they hired a new young guitarist who was absolutely off the chain, honey. And this guy's name was Jimi Hendrix. And although Jimi could play and he was a great addition, Jimi wanted to be a star in his own right. And so the reason for him getting with the Isley Brothers is so he could kind of jumpstart his career, kind of piggyback off of their success. But see, the joke was on Jimi because child, he got to playing with them folks and the next couple of songs they put out was flops. And I guess they wasn't really pure D flops, but they certainly were not hits. Jimi found out he couldn't be no star playing with these folks. Child, he got his stuff and he got up out of there. After this, the Osley Brothers ended up signing with Motown and they did release one song, which was called This Old Heart of Mine, and it did end up being a top 40 hit, but once again, the well ran dry. But these boys, and really like young men by this time, they must have felt success like just deep in their bones. They must have knew that they were meant to be something, and they were right. Baby, when the 1970s hit, the Osley Brothers did that thing, honey. Baby, they signed with Buddha Records and put out a song called It's Your Thing, and child, the song was not just your thing, the song was my thing, they thing, everybody thing, because everybody was running around singing. I can't tell you, come on now, who to sock it to, the great A money making hit. I'm talking about money making to the tune of over $1 million. And everybody was wondering what changed, you know, what happened to your sound to make this song blow like it did. And I'll tell you what changed. His name was Ernie Isley. Because see, in 1969, the Isley brothers added Ernie Isley, a guy named Chris Jasper, as well as another brother named Marvin Isley. And It's Your Thing was the first song that Ernie Isley was recorded playing bass on. And Ernie was that dude on that bass, baby. Oh, and then speaking of Ernie, here go a little tea. Now, baby, the folks on the street said that they thought Ernie Isley was gay. But notice I used the word thought. Out of all the research that I did, I did not see anything that would support the evidence of that. And honestly, what I did see was a whole bunch of people who assumed he was gay because of the way he dressed in the 70s. And it was very feminine with like the tied up tops and the hip huggers and things like that. But I thought a few men were dressing like that back then. But I guess, child, maybe Ernie wore it better than everybody else, honey. So anyways, It's Your Thing is a huge success. Everybody is cheesing and happy and smiling, but baby, there was one person who was peeking around the corner, frowned up, honey. Berry Gordy had missed out on some money, honey, and somebody was going to court because he didn't play that. And what happened is Berry Gordy took the Osley Brothers to court, and what he said is that when It's Your Thing came out, they were still signed to Motown. And of course, Run and his brothers fought this and said that's a lie. They were already signed to Buddha. And luckily, the judge sided with the Osley brothers. This win added to the celebratory atmosphere even more. And so the Osley brothers were in a fervor trying to come up with more hits. Their catalog was popping during this time because they came up with Summer Bree, Love the One You're With, Pop That Thing, For the Love of You, and actually that For the Love of You album went platinum. Baby hit number one on the LP charts and sold over 2 million copies. So it was clear to the Osley brothers as well as the world that they had made it, they were on top, and they were coasting. And so now that we got here, let's take a break from the music for a little second, honey, and hit on the start of this tea train. Now child, listen at this. Why come the folks said that Rudy Osley was going around and hitting his brothers with wooden bed slats when they were younger? Baby said that if his brothers made him mad or he felt like his brothers were not minding him, that Rudy would go and pick up that bed slat and come through like WWE and slam it across his brother's bed. And this next rumor says that Run ended up marrying a woman named Margaret Tinsley in the year 1960, and they had a daughter named Tia Osley in the year 1969. And that Rudy Osley married a woman named Elaine Jasper, who was actually Chris Jasper's sister, in 1958. And honey, the brothers may have been happily married, but child, these folks out here say they were some scoundrels, baby. All three of them. Because see, this is at the time when it was only three Osley brothers. Honey, they say that them men was just sleeping around with different women here and there. Child said they was covering for each other and everything. Oh no, don't worry about it. Run is with me tonight. Shirley, don't be asking about O'Kelly. He hanging out with his brothers. And yeah, O'Kelly might have been with his brothers, but they sure ain't said nothing about that woman in the back room that all three of them finna sit up there and mess around with. Speaking of Run Osley and other women, chai, it's some gossip on the streets that claims that Run Osley, who has three children that he claims, baby, the folks claim that he has three other children that are illegitimate. And it's actually even some deeper things that are alleged about Run and other women, but we'll get to that in just a minute. Speaking of Osley children, Rudolph had some kids and set to knocking them out just like he did his brothers, except this time, supposedly he was using a wooden bat. This next little tea on the streets talks about the time that Wilson Pickett was drunk and outside of somebody's house, and Rudolph Osley was in this house. And Wilson Pickett was like yelling and fighting outside, and he was drunk and stuff, and I guess Rudolph was on the side of the person that Wilson was arguing with. And so you know Rudolph is the kind of big brother, you know what I'm saying, the tall one, and actually the one that a lot of folks on the street, so I saw, thought was the most handsome brother. But anyway, so Rudolph is all big, so he comes walking out the house, stumping up on Wilson Pickett, and starts to wear Wilson Pickett out. Well, Wilson Pickett is trying to block himself, and then he reaches down, child, them folks said that Rudolph disappeared in thin air, baby. Teleportation, honey, said that they didn't even see Rudolph running in the house. All they saw was Wilson Pickett pull out a gun, and next thing you know, they looking for Rudy. He was back in the house behind the screen door looking. Then you have the rumors of what was happening inside of the group. Word on the streets is that the Osley brothers began having problems as early as 1980. And come to find out, O'Kelly, Run, and Rudy were cheating their younger brothers, Ernie Osley and Marvin Osley, and Chris Jasper out of money. Baby, the folks say that this was sure enough low down and dirty, because the folks say that without Ernie and Chris Jasper especially, that the Osley brothers would have still been a doggone group that was getting a hit every 10 years. Because you know, I already told you what Ernie did with that guitar. Well, it said that Chris Jasper, ever since he had joined the group in 1969, that he was the one that had written all of the hits for all of the Osley brothers. And it's claimed that Run added his name as well as all of the other brothers' names to the songwriting credits. Now, Chris Jasper may not have been too upset about this, but when he found out he was getting cut out of some of the pay, oh yes, he was very ticked, because I'm already letting y'all slide by getting these songwriting credits when y'all ain't wrote a doggone word, and then y'all cutting money out from me too? Baby, somebody better do something. And so supposedly when Chris came with this anger or these complaints to Ernie and Marvin, who were also upset about getting cut out of the money, they started wanting to come up with a group of their own. So by 1984, they did end up leaving the group and they came up with their own group, Osley Jasper Osley. Now with Ernie, Chris Jasper, and Marvin gone, baby, the word on the streets is that the Osley brothers may as well changed into the Dem Osley brothers, because the group was certainly in a demise after those three had left. Now they tried to slide out a little album called Masterpiece, thinking the women was gonna buy because they was on the cover looking all distinguished and wealthy. Baby, them folks got dressed up for nothing. Not only did the women not notice the album covers, they probably was laughing about the album cover because the Osley brothers were sitting up there trying to look like the Godfathers, but ended up looking like the stepfather. Now child, y'all know the tea have to get a little bit messier and a little bit dirtier. Let me start off with this. So O'Kelly Osley ended up passing away in the year of 1986 at the age of 48. Said he had a sudden heart attack and he also had cancer. But child, they say the sudden heart attack was caused by somebody giving O'Kelly the ride of his life, honey. Said the ride took his life. Baby said that man was in the bed with somebody. When I researched this deeper, some folks said it was true and they knew this for a fact. But then another group of people said that this was not true and said the only reason that the rumor got around is because The Color Purple came out the year before, and after that movie came out, basically everybody that died, like after that, they started saying that they died in the bed with some woman. Now check me out. The folks say that Ron Osley was grieving over O'Kelly, but baby, he spotted something that got him over that little grief real quick. Said her name was Angela Winbush. Baby say that Ron was all kinds of turned on when he seen her performing with Renee Moore, so turned on that he rushed to Benny Medina telling him, hey, you got to go get that Angela Winbush. I want her on my team. I want her producing me some babies. I mean, I want her producing me some music. And say that Benny Medina went and got her, honey. Child, the folks said it was a whole bunch of flirting and a whole bunch of tee-hee-hees going on when they was working together. Said they grew real close. And it did not hurt that Angela was producing some epic hits for them through the 80s. People started to notice that Angela and Run were getting close, but every time somebody asked her or him, oh no, we just friends, that's just my home girl. And this is because Angela Winbush was alleged to be dating Renee Moore. And here's one more thing that's alleged. It's claimed that Renee Moore used to beat on Angela Winbush, like very badly. Honey, they say it was one day that the Osley brothers was at a concert and Angela was backstage with Renee. And I guess Angela was looking too hard at Run, or she maybe had said, sang Run one too many times, whatever she did. Baby, it's claimed that Renee Moore lit into her, honey. Baby, they say he was busting Angela all upside her head. But see, in the midst of the slaps, Ron Osley supposedly ran backstage and basically was like, hey man, get off of her. You know what you doing? What's wrong with you? And pulled Renee off of her. And then he went over to comfort Angela. And baby, I guess the comforting got a little good, baby, because they say that after this, Ron and Angela started messing around. And then in 1990, Rudy ended up leaving the Osley brothers because he had found God and he became a minister. And this is where things get a little bit strange, because the folks say that now that O'Kelly was dead and Rudy had left the Osley brothers, baby, they said that Run didn't really know what to do. Said he was acting confused and wearing the same outfit like several days in a row. But child, of folks say he wasn't too confused or depressed. He was sitting up there stroking up Angela any chance he got. In fact, Angela and Run by this time were said to be an actual couple. And when they became a couple, or even before they became a couple, baby, it said that Angela was Run's down at shit. Said that it was certain folks in the music industry that owed Run money, but they wouldn't pay him. Baby, they said that Angela would get on that doggone phone and turn into a thug for her man, baby, and get that doggone money. It's also claimed that she would take care of everything on the business end. You know what I'm saying? Any papers, any documents, any legal stuff. It's like Run Osley was the face. He was out forward, but Angela was behind the scenes, everything to Run Osley. And Run admired this so much that he and Angela ended up getting married in 1993. Baby, they said Run switched up on that woman like a Mighty Morphin Power Ranger, child. Said he played it cool for a couple of years, then got out here and started hanging and banging. And the folks say that one of the reasons he started hanging out so tough is because he was now working with this new young hot producer as well as musical artist, R. Kelly. And word on the street says R. Kelly sought out Ron Osley because he had come up with a new musical character and he was getting ready to do his first movie music video. And that video was called Keep It On The Down Low. And so inside of this video, he had a character named Mr. Biggs and he wanted Ron Osley to play that character. And so as I said, Ron Osley and R. Kelly starts to hang together because they start to work together. And baby, you know it's a scandalous thing, child. Because it's claimed that R. Kelly was sitting up there calling Ron dad and would call call Angela mom. But what kind of mom is Angela to you when you sitting up there taking dad from the house and having him clubbing and all up around different women? And so the folks say that Ron Osley had already started cheating anyway, but now he was basically getting his honey on the side double time because, like I said, he was out hanging with this new young artist. Now, if you are wondering about R. Kelly calling Ron Osley dad, it is said that Ron Osley was a father figure for R. Kelly. And it's some gossip out here that claims that R. Kelly's mother, Joanne, told Ron Osley, hey, I want you to look after my son. I want you to be a father figure to my son. But this right here, first of all, it sounds dramatic, like something from a movie. And then second of all, Joanne died in 1993. So dang, that must have meant that R. Kelly and Ron got close like this, like very quickly. So I don't know if I believe that part about his mother asking that, but regardless of whether she asked or not, Ron Osley was basically a father to R. Kelly. To move on, Talk on the Street says that Ron Osley definitely changed once he started playing the Mr. Big character. Baby, they said Ron was out here acting like other folks that was coming up in the music industry needed to go through him. You know what I'm saying? Like they had to talk to him to get his approval, like he was the Don pretty much, especially if somebody else wanted to work with R. Kelly. Now, another person that Ron started working with at this time is Kelly Price, and per the word on the streets, Kelly Price was about to be signed to another label, and the label told her that she was too big. You know what I'm saying? They said that she needed to lose weight. Kelly Price told them, I'm not losing a doggone thing. Well, if Ron Osley had heard her sing, or she was like one of the background singers somewhere, something like that, but whatever the case, he told her that, you know, I want you to come sing with me. Actually, I want you to produce me. And that's what Kelly Price did. And so Ron basically cultivated her into her own star. And that's how you get down to this system where Kelly Price at one point was calling R. Kelly her brother, because it was basically like she was Ron Osley's daughter or niece or something, like the videos say, and he was his son. So they were kind of like one little family. Now back to Angela. Gossip on the streets claims that when she started to complain to Ron about this new attitude, like Patti LaBelle, that Ron basically started to be like, you know, watch your mouth. Like he really thought he was Mr. Big, y'all. I'm sorry. It ain't funny, but it kind of is. But they did say that he really tried to start acting like Mr. Big or somebody. Then, honey, it gets a little bit spicy and a little messy because it's claimed that one time he had said, watch your mouth. Angela was like, who you talking to? Baby, it's claimed that Ron Osley bust her all upside the head. But the thing is that if Ron Osley really was beating on Angela, she took every blow, she took every side chick, and she took every baby, because baby, it's multiple rumors out here that Ron Osley had plenty of side baby. And child, they said Ron was out here twisting hoes' arms up left and right, child, forcing them women to get abortion. And what? Child. Yes, honey, because it's claimed that the women that he could not force to get an abortion, a lot of those women took him to paternity court. And gossip on the street said that Ron Osley paid big money to have these paternity cases hushed hush. And you have to remember, the whole time Ron is supposedly doing all of this, not only is Angela with him, she is like still helping him produce his music. As a matter of fact, while he was working with R. Kelly, she still was coming into the studio, making sure his vocals were right, you know, staying after hours and stuff like that, while Ron is out here living his best life, I guess. And then listen to this little rumor, honey. Baby, the folks on the street say that Ron couldn't be possessive over Angela because he was too busy being possessive over R. Kelly, honey. Cha said that Ron ran plenty of folks off that wanted to work with R. Kelly. Baby said he tried to intimidate and run Charlie Wilson off. The T on the street says that R. Kelly got word that Charlie Wilson was trying to get in touch with him and work with him. And baby said Ron Osley started hating, honey. Said Ron Osley was all up in R. Kelly's ear talking about some, you really need to see what kind of intentions Charlie got. Like, why does he want to work with you? Like, what is it? When R. Kelly did agree to meet with Charlie Wilson, Ron Osley basically kept R. Kelly out all day, had the man like 2 hours late for the meeting just to basically try to disrespect Charlie Wilson. And one thing about it is that R. Kelly, messy tale, was said to enjoy this exchange, said that he kept up the mess between the two men, honey. Baby, they said that when R. Kelly would go meet or talk to Charlie Wilson, he would say things like, you know, I hear what you saying, but I need to go back and check in with Mr. Biggs because, you know, everything needs to run through him, so we need to see what he says about it. Basically just picking, but Charlie Wilson wanted to revive his career, so he took it. Speaking of the Mr. Big character, the character itself, it is claimed that R. Kelly wanted to be that character. Like, that character is how he envisioned himself, how he wanted to be. So that character is R. Kelly, and if that rumor is true, that is a major bomb drop, because if you think back to the Mr. Big character and the things that he did on the Down Low video and the way Fancy ended up, Now, at this point, Ron Isley already sitting up there doing too much. But baby, the folks say that he got to hanging out with Philip Bailey from Earth, Wind, and Fire, and child, them two old men was cutting up out here. And honey, the folks say that Philip Bailey was cheating so doggone bad that he drove his wife to drinking and possibly drugs. Now in 2001, Angela Wimbush finally had enough of Ron Isley and she divorced him. And then sadly in 2002, she started battling cancer. But folks say throughout the divorce and the cancer, Ron kept doing him like ain't nothing happened, because see, word on the streets is that Ron had already gotten into a pretty serious relationship even before he and Angela divorced. Now baby, come in close and listen to this, because see, now it's alleged that around the year of 1997, while Ron Isley was hanging very tough at R. Kelly's house, he ended up meeting a young lady there by the name of Candy. And Candy was actually a part of a singing group. It was her sister Kim and another sister, and they were working with R. Kelly because they were trying to get their careers off of the ground. Well, word on the street is that Ron and Candy got really, really close. And around this time, I think she was around 20 years old. And Ron was 59 years old. Well, I don't really know how to explain to you how the relationship between Candy and Ron Isley was, but for some reason, it's rumored out here on these streets that they got into some wild and strange things. Now, there is a blind item going around online. This blind item does not say that it's Ron and Candy, but a lot of people feel like it's based on Ron Isley, Candy, Philip Bailey, and Candy's sister. And I'm about to put it on the screen. Read the blind item and you guys will see why people think that Ron and Candy had this really wild affair.
Hey guys, because this is alleged and this does not actually say Ron's name, I'm not going to read it. But if you are having a hard time seeing it on the screen, I'm going to put the link in the description. You can click on the link in the description and it'll take you to the actual site where this comment was.
Y'all, ain't that some crazy behind mess? Now that is some gossip and tea for your behind. I don't care, honey. Now I will say again that that article does not say that it is Ron Isley that it's talking about. It does not say Candy, Philip Bailey. It does not say that. But people seem to assume that that is who the article is about, especially because Ron Isley did end up marrying Candy, and we'll talk about that a little bit later, and Philip Bailey did end up marrying Candy's sister. Now, you do have some naysayers out here that says that that article couldn't possibly be Ron Isley because Ron Isley never did any drugs and alcohol throughout his career. But child, Ron Isley might not have done drugs and alcohol, but what about Mr. Biggs? I done told y'all they say that Mr. Biggs really became his alter ego. Mr. Biggs was out here acting in a way that probably Ron Isley would never act like. If the article is correct or telling the truth, and if the article is about Ron Isley, then that would mean that the real reason that Angela Wimbush left him is because allegedly he gave someone an STD. Ron Isley was possibly out here getting down like that because, see, baby, a lot of y'all only know about Candy, who he was messing around with at this time. Baby, y'all don't know nothing about Safari from Flavor of Love. Boom, baby. Now, word on the street is that Safari started messing with Ron Isley as soon as he divorced Angela Wimbush. And, baby, the scandal, child. The scandal, because I found an interview that Safari did and she talked about her and Ron's relationship. And in that interview, she said she knew he had a girlfriend, but she said she wasn't worried about that girlfriend because the girlfriend wasn't important. Plus, she didn't have a lot of respect for a woman that would come in between a marriage. Now, all of this mess we've been just talking about, apparently all of this stuff happened in like the years of 2000, 2001, 2002, 2003. Well, now let me sprinkle a little bit more tea on here. Because see, in 2004, Ron Isley ended up having a stroke. And baby, they say Angela Wimbush lost her mind, child. Baby, she just a crying and just a hollering. She was in tears, honey. She just had to go and see about her man. Honey, the folks say that Angela felt like she needed to step up and take care of Ron. And it is alleged that Angela actually said, his new woman, that little young girl, don't know what to do. Baby, listen, all I know is that it's claimed that Angela Wimbush stepped up and she took care of Ron. She got him anything that he needed and she nursed him back to health. And to wrap up the story about Safari, she said that she and Run were in love and that they dated at least 2 to 3 years. And then she said he came to her in 2005 out of nowhere and told her he was getting married to his girlfriend. And so Safari was like hurt because she didn't understand how this would just pop up out of nowhere. But baby, it's some tea on the streets about that too, because child, the folks out here are saying that the reason it was so sudden is because Run was forced to marry Kim. Now, I cannot and will not spell that out because I don't have the receipts. All I know, the marriage supposedly happened in 2005 and Candy was 28 years old and Ron Osley was 63 years old. After they got married, Candy ended up getting pregnant. And this story is certainly messy enough, but now it's time to sprinkle a little bit more mess in here, baby, because it's claimed that the reason that you never saw another collaboration with Mr. Biggs and R. Kelly after 2003, which is when Busted came out, as well as the Chocolate Factory album, is because R. Kelly felt a certain way about Mr. Biggs marrying Candy. And so, even if they were not dating, maybe R. Kelly felt like he had some sort of possession over her? But anyway, by the year 2006, Candy Isley is pregnant, and I am sure that this is a joyous moment for Candy as well as Run. But there was some entity that was not having fun at all, and that was the IRS. And they basically was like, hey, Run, hey! Do you got our money? And surprisingly, Ron Osley actually did have some money to give them. But the problem with that is that that was his dead brother's money. You see, not only had Ron Osley been skipping out on his taxes for years, he also had been cashing his dead brother's check. Baby, these folks out here saying that Ron stole all O'Kelly's money, child. And so the IRS was like, sir, you're doing too much. It's time to go to trial. And then Ron Osley was like, that's the other Mr. Biggs. I'm this Mr. Biggs. Put it in the comments and let me know if y'all caught that little Easter egg. But anyways, yes, Ron Osley ended up facing charges and he did end up going to trial. And girl, they said Ron Osley come up in there, eyes half closed, he just holding his chest, just half dead, child. Baby, Ron got up there telling that judge, nah, I ain't long for this world now. The doctor have said that I will be dead at any day. Now, is you really gonna send an elderly, sick man that's finna die any day to prison? Child said the judge pointed to his pregnant wife and told him, you ain't too sick. You still got enough strength to crawl up in between. And they sentenced him to 3 years in prison. And gossip claims that prison was a walk in the park for Ron Osley, honey. As a matter of fact, said he loved prison. You know why? Because he was Mr. Big in prison. Once again, any business to be conducted needed to go through him. Anybody wanted any favors, any loans, he got it. You know what I'm saying? So he really could play up the role of being the Don in there. And while Run was role playing like he was Frank Lucas or somebody, child, here come Angela just a running through crying and screaming and stuff all over again. Child, she just a heartbroken that Run is in prison. They say that Angela be suited up and booted up on the weekends, ready to make them doggone visit. But honestly, even though I do believe that Angela Winbush came and took care of Run during his stroke, I kind of find it hard to believe that she was going to prison to visit him. Because if that's the case, when Run was asked about it, he sure didn't mention her. He basically only said that his wife Candy, their son, and a daughter came to visit him 3 times a week. He didn't say nothing about Angela. And honestly, that's right. He should have been giving props to his wife Candy. She is his wife. That's where the props should have came to. But maybe he should have said something about Angela if she was coming to the jail too. See, that's why I don't believe that. And also, if Angela was coming to that jail to visit him, maybe she shouldn't have. And I know y'all are gonna say, but Ashley, you know, that's his ex-wife. She's good-hearted. You know, she and Run have been friends for years. And, you know, now they were cordial and all that good stuff. Baby, nuh-uh. Because as early as 2011, Angela Winbush was standing on a doggone stage complaining about how Mr. Big did her wrong. And if you think I'm lying, go to the pinned comment and click the link and go to the timestamps. The first timestamp is Angela talking about Mr. Big done her wrong, and the second timestamp is Auntie Angie girl getting down, child. Baby, Angela Winbush was showing them men what they was missing. You hear me? Honey, she was showing Run what he was missing in that second timestamp. Go watch it, baby. Y'all are gonna be sent to heaven, honey. But back to the tea. After Run got out of prison, he came out and it seems like he settled down into a normal life. But as we all know, and as this story tells us, Run is apparently a sucker for a young, pretty face. The hot tea on the street says that in 2015, Run let a pretty pretty little thing by the name of Elise Murray talk him into giving her $30,000 to invest for him. And you know, run. I just wanna see. Yes, run. You grow my money. Child, that girl took that $30,000 and put it in her doggone pocket and then went and got a $60,000 loan in Run's name. Or at least this is what Run accused her of, which is why he ended up suing her for over $1 million. Now, I am not sure what the outcome of this lawsuit was, but when I looked up Elise Group 7 on Google and it looks like it has a one-star review, but when you read the review, somebody that messed around and gave that girl one star because they talking about the AC unit outside of her business make noises all year. But we are now at the end of our story. To wrap things up, Ron and his wife Candy are still married. I think they've been married around 16, 17 years at this point, so they are definitely still going strong. Now, regarding R. Kelly, as I stated before and in this video, it said the reason their relationship was so close is because Ron Isley truly looked at R. Kelly like a son. I don't know if they still have that type of relationship. I highly doubt it. And also, some of you guys in the comments were trying to know if Ron Isley knew about what R. Kelly was doing or had any type of involvement in that. I can't say for certain if he did or didn't because I wasn't there, but I can say for certain out of all of the deep digging I did and all of the emails that were sent to me, not one said anything about Ron Isley knowing what R. Kelly was doing, and he certainly didn't get involved with any underage girls. Now, of course, he liked young women, but they were still adult women. But anyway, like I told y'all before, Ron's tea was so hot because it involved so many other people, but it seems like all of the extra characters that I mentioned in this story outside of the Isley brothers are all doing well and they are living their best lives, well, except R. Kelly. But everybody else, everything seems well.
I need to cut in here, guys, and I wanted to let you guys know that Marvin Isley actually passed away on June the 6th, 2010 from complications of diabetes, and it had gotten so bad where his legs had to be amputated. He was only 56 years old.
So, this is the end of the old Hollywood scandalous story of Mr. Ron Isley. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Please like, comment, and share. And like, once again, I keep telling y'all, like this video, guys. I love y'all so much. I'll see y'all again soon. Bye.